Morning is none other than Dr. Jacob Shabani, who is from Aga Khan University and is a family medicine physician. Thank you for joining us, sir.
Thank you.
And this morning we'd like to talk about cholera. Now, let's just start with the fact that there was an outbreak, and maybe just to get it from you, whether that outbreak so far has been contained.
Yeah, so the outbreak occurred in Mandera in the former northeastern province. Mm-hmm. The outbreak has now been contained. We are not hearing of any more deaths resulting from cholera.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So that is good news, of course. But let's start first of all with what would be the cause of cholera? Because in this day and age, really, should we be talking about diseases like cholera?
Yeah, it's a pity that we still talk about cholera. It should be ideally controlled by now in the advancements that you're having. Tracking back, cholera is actually caused by a bacteria that we call Vibrio cholerae. This is transmitted by contaminated stool. So a patient infected with this bacteria passes out the bacteria in the stool, and if this stool gets into our water sources and our food sources, then you pick up cholera.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. And by virtue of the fact that it is passed, it's contained in stool and passed through that, would it then be accurate to say that it is more of a sanitation issue when we have an outbreak?
Yeah, that's precisely the point. Many areas where outbreaks of cholera occur, they have got poor sewerage systems. It's very common that you find cholera in outbreaks after rains, in slum areas where there's no good disposal of fecal material. We encourage people to dig pit latrines away from water sources, at least 30 meters away from water sources, so that when you get the surface runoff from the rains, it doesn't get into these water sources and contaminate the,
water. When now we are when you talk about pit latrines and possibly those who would be in an area where they're using pit latrines, it is likely their water source could also be from a well. Exactly. Is there a risk of contamination, especially now that it's under both of them are, you know, below a certain depth?
Yes, there is a risk of contamination if your pit latrine is very close to your well. There are public health recommendations in areas that we dig pit latrines to say that this should be at least 30 meters away from each other, so that your water source and your pit latrine are far apart.
Okay.
The tragedy is that sometimes in some areas people still don't dig pit latrines. There is fecal deposition in open spaces. And this makes it very easy for contamination. You can get burst sewer pipes with water runoff overwhelming these sewer lines. In some areas, the sewer lines run close to the clean water surfaces. And this makes it easier for that contamination to occur.
Okay. Yes. Let's go back to the causes. And what's the original genesis of the bacteria? We know that it is being passed through stool. But for you to possibly have that bacteria, what's the original genesis for it?
Yeah, this bacteria is actually found commonly in areas of Africa, Asia, and even in developing countries like the U.S. Usually very well contained when there's good sanitation. So the challenge is that when there's a break in these good practices of sanitation, you find that the bacteria finding its way into water and food sources. Most of the time it comes out in epidemics. So you'll not be surprised that after the rains, when there's a lot of surface water running and destroying sewer lines or possibly contaminating and overflowing pit latrines, then this contaminated fecal material that has got this bacteria gets into our water sources.
Okay.
Yes.
Let's look at symptoms for somebody who now may want to know whether it's cholera or it's just food poisoning. What are some of the symptoms?
So cholera, we term it as an acute diarrheal illness. So typically after exposure to the bacteria, you might get your symptoms within hours to about 2 to 3 days. It comes with profuse diarrhea, sometimes with vomiting and cramping. The cramping muscle pains result because you lose a lot of body water as well as a lot of the body salts, what we call electrolytes. The good news is that most cases of cholera actually come as a mild illness. So it's only about 10 to 15% where you progress to this severe illness that is that has diarrhea, vomiting, And when you lose a lot of body water, you get dehydrated. Mm-hmm. It's at this point that the risk to life emanates, that dehydration causes deaths, okay, unfortunately.
For the benefit of just differentiating between what you term as not cholera diarrhea, I don't want to call it normal because diarrhea really is not normal, but non-cholera diarrhea, when you talk about acute diarrhea, what's the difference between just diarrhea and acute diarrhea?
So acute diarrhea is where typically you'll get a diarrheal illness within 1 week of exposure to the offending disease-causing agent. In most of the time, as I said, is that you get exposed and within hours you're already sick with diarrhea. What is unique about cholera diarrhea is that it's profuse. You have many bouts of diarrhea within a short period. The diarrhea is classically defined as rice water diarrhea. So it looks like when you wash your rice, the whitish water refuse that comes out of washing rice, that's the kind of diarrhea that you have.
Okay.
It's as opposed to other causes of diarrhea, sometimes people have problems with absorbing certain kinds of food. So you find that over the weeks, you have 2 weeks, 3 weeks, a month even, you have a diarrheal illness. That will not be cholera. Cholera really falls within the scope that within hours of exposure to 2 to 3 days that you have diarrhea.
Okay. Possibly before we go to the cure, because one, naturally what we normally do is that when you're unwell, you kind of want to give yourself a bit of time and, you know, just to assess how bad it is and hoping that it's going to fade away. One, is there a risk of doing that when it is cholera? And two, what's the time frame that one should give himself so that you can now decide that this has gone beyond and I better not wait. Let me get some medical help.
Yes, one of the key things is that cholera will occur in areas where you've had this been an epidemic.
Right.
So if you're in an area where there's an epidemic or you've come into contact with someone from those areas, you'll not want to ignore a diarrheal illness. With cholera, the bouts of diarrhea are very frequent. So typically you have 10, 12 or so bouts within a very short period, like 30 minutes.
Wow.
So you progressively get very weak. Especially in children and in elderly people, the deterioration can be in hours. So one of the key things is that if you notice that you have a lot of bouts of diarrhea, if you feel that you're getting weak and your lips are dry, in children sometimes you get sunken eyes, tainting skin, you become very lethargic and weak, then it's time for you to seek attention at a medical facility very fast. I think the key thing is that when you are thinking of cholera is not to delay, to wait to find out how things will progress. When severe, cholera also sometimes is accompanied with vomiting, and this will further worsen the dehydration. So anyone suspecting, if you have an inkling that this might be cholera, the best thing is to go to the nearest health facility. While you're doing that, there are oral rehydration salts that can aid you reach the facility. In some of these areas where cholera outbreaks occur, the nearest health facility is not close by. So getting your oral rehydration salt started early in the process of BU being transferred is very key.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, there are also, we have anti-diarrhea mixtures and medicines that sometimes you can buy from a chemist. Does that particularly deal with the diarrhea for cholera? Because, I mean, like I said, naturally, we tend to take things lightly until now, you know, you feel that, whoa, this has really gone beyond normal. So naturally, if somebody's diarrhea-ing, you may walk up to a chemist and just ask for an anti-diarrhea mixture. Does that help in terms of cholera?
No, it doesn't help, and it's actually not a good practice to encourage. The mainstay of treatment for cholera is actually fluid replacement, what you're losing. So the first aid measure actually is to use these oral rehydration salts so that in your in the process of you getting to the nearest health facility. Many people with cholera actually sometimes need intravenous infusion of fluids because they lose a lot of fluids and salts within a very short time. So the message really is if you suspect that you have diarrhea that could be emanating from cholera, is to you to get to a nearest health facility and start the rehydration salts. Mm-hmm. Don't use any anti-diarrheal medicine and don't waste time going to a facility, for example, that can't put an intravenous line for you. You need to go to a facility where fluid resuscitation can be instituted immediately.
It's life. All right. And now while we are on self-medication, because again, that is it's a very Kenyan thing. Mm-hmm. And especially even to self-diagnose, you'll find mm-hmm. somebody maybe who has aching joints mm-hmm. And feeling a little bit shiverish or even, a fever.
Yes.
Normally we say malaria. Mm-hmm. So immediately you go to the chemist and tell them, nataka dawa ya malaria. And we have anti-malaria, malaria queen and all that, anti-malaria medicine mm-hmm. that is in the market. Maybe now that we're on that, you, as a doctor, your view on self-medication and self-prescription?
Self-prescription is a dangerous practice. As you've said, not every fever is malaria. Mm. Fever is a sign of any illness occurring in the body, and the body that is trying to fight the illness, the effect of that is that you develop a fever. So kind of like a warning sign that things are not good. Something is not right. It's doctors who are trained for many years to be able to diagnose and know what is not right with you. And taking shortcuts where you go to a pharmacy or a chemist or a shop to get medication is the wrong way to go, because you might be treated for something that you do not have. That, of course, can come with dangerous consequences. The illness that you're having could get worse. Sometimes you might be given medication like antibiotics, which you don't need, and you further what you call resistance to medication, which means that the next time you actually get an illness that needs that medication won't work for you. And it's not only you. You actually affect the whole community. Mm-hmm. So the best practice is always seek the advice and counsel of a health provider so that you can be properly diagnosed and the right treatment instituted.
Administered to you.
Yes.
All right, let's go to the cure of cholera. What are the process and what's the cure for cholera?
So the treatment for cholera is replacement of the body fluids and salts that you're losing because of the diarrheal illness. That's what has been shown to work all over where epidemics occur and what research is showing. Previously, we used to give antibiotics in cases of cholera, but there isn't much good evidence that works very well, mm-hmm. apart from the key thing of instituting replacement of the fluid that you've lost. Mm-hmm. In some severe cases, an antibiotic might be given, but the emphasis of the doctors is actually to get the fluids given. And we usually start with oral rehydration salts. In many cases of people with severe cholera, you actually need an IV infusion.
Okay.
The IV infusion helps you because it replaces the salts that you're losing and also the water that you've
mentioned
lost from
the body. Oral salts that yes. one can take, and even mentioned if you're in a remote area mm. before you get to a medical facility or a place where they can attend to you, you need to be taking those oral salts. What are those oral salts?
So these are commercially prepared rehydration salts, mm-hmm. and they contain a mixture of some of the salts that we lose a lot when you have diarrheal illness, which is sodium and potassium in a mixture. You could try to make a homemade solution of oral rehydration salts. Not very much encouraged nowadays because you might not get the proportion very well.
Correct.
The oral rehydration salts are available even at the most basic of health facilities in government settings and in chemists. It's good to have some of these at home, and they usually come in sachets, you find that one sachet can be used to make about a liter of fluid. Mm-hmm. And you take as much as you can of these oral rehydration salts when you're having diarrheal illness. We recommend that you take about 70 ml per diarrheal bout as a minimum. But if you can take more, you drink more.
You encourage to drink more.
Yes.
And is it in the case where you do not have the oral salts available, is it okay to just take plain water?
Yeah, water helps a little bit, but if you can add a little bit of salt and sugar.
Just the normal salt.
Yeah, normal salt and sugar. Mm-hmm. On your way to the health facility. So I think that's very important that you're not just doing the oral rehydration salts and waiting at home. Mm. Now, this is sort of a first aid measure to your way as you head to a health facility. Okay.
What about other fluids? Because you've mentioned severally that one of the things that you lose a lot is you dehydrate.
Yes.
And that is because of diarrhea and vomiting. Mm-hmm. Are other fluids encouraged? For instance, one might, you know, be feeling hungry and maybe want to take tea or juice.
Yeah, any fluid you can get to will be encouraged. You don't want very sugary fluids, so things like sodas or juices are not ideal. Mm-hmm. For children who are breastfeeding, we'll encourage mothers to continue breastfeeding. So breast milk is actually a good way to replenish your fluids. But for adults, get the oral rehydration salts, water on your way in. You could do a tea and without milk, usually, because most diarrheal illnesses are actually worsened a bit because some people are milk intolerant. Mm, yeah, so that lactose. When you take lactose intolerant, so when you take milk, the diarrheal illness becomes worse. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay, so that the fluids are encouraged and that is all good. Now, you've talked about young ones, infants who are still on mama's milk, being encouraged to take that milk. Is it possible to pass on the bacteria from mother to child through the milk?
Not through the milk, because cholera is transmitted through contaminated feces.
Feces, okay.
So the infant's diapers can actually transmit cholera to the mom. We encourage caregivers to always wash their hands before and after attending to a child and changing the diapers and so on. Mm-hmm. And the key thing really to prevent cholera is if we practice good hygiene. We say that look for opportunities where you need to wash your hands. So every time before you prepare food, you need to wash your hands. Before you eat, you need to wash your hands. Before and after eating, before and after visiting the toilet, before you handle, let's say, infant diapers and nappies. Mm-hmm. And mothers who are breastfeeding, we always encourage you that you wash your hands before you breastfeed and after nursing. So, and the technique of washing hands is also very important.
What's the technique of washing hands? I was actually coming to that because I know there are some of us who feel the minute you run water, you know, your hands under water, you've washed. Mm-hmm. Others may not even have running water per se.
Yes.
You may be using stagnant water. And take us through the process of now having your hands sanitized and cleaned.
So the proper way to wash your hands, first of all, you need to have running water. So it can be tap water. It can be a modified, like in areas where the water resources is limited. You can modify a jerry can and have a small hole dug at the end so that you have dripping water. So the water is running and you should use soap. If you do not have soap and water, we can use alcohol-based hand sanitizers. Once you get these ingredients, then the technique of washing hands is you take your time to wash hands. So generally we have the 7 steps of washing hands. So first of all, with running water, you're rubbing your hands, you wash, make sure that you wash the thumbs on both sides, make sure that you engage around the knuckles, and make sure that you wash as well on these other sides as well, and making sure that you wash also your wrist areas. You should remove watches and bracelets. Possibly the only thing you should leave is your wedding band. And make sure,
in case you get in trouble with the missus.
Yes, exactly.
Or the mister, in that case. All right, now, that is all good. But something else you've mentioned, especially in an urban setting, we have nowadays you can buy in a supermarket sanitizers. Mm-hmm. How effective are they, especially when you use them just before eating? I've seen people literally not have running water, but use a sanitizer and it evaporates. And how effective are those sanitizers?
They are very effective in cleansing hands, but you should know when not to use them. Mm-hmm. So when your hands are visibly soiled, you should not use them. You should use water and soap. In situations where they are not visibly soiled, then actually they are quite good at sanitizing and you should use them for every opportunity.
Would they be advisable even in places where there's an outbreak? Would they work?
Yes. For example, in healthcare settings, you'll find that you have the hand sanitizers so that in between patients, healthcare workers can wash their hands, or people getting into patient areas can wash their hands before they handle or interact with the patient. Mm-hmm. The key thing is that if you are visibly soiled, or if you've used, for example, healthcare workers use gloves, there will be powder on it. You need to use water and
water,
soap
to wash off that powder. Mm-hmm. Let's go back to the symptoms and concentrate mainly on infants.
Yes.
Because I imagine, like you mentioned, for the infants and for the elderly, mm-hmm. their rate of deterioration is very fast,
yes.
and can also be very risky.
Yes.
For infants, are there external symptoms that one can observe by virtue of the fact that an infant may be in diapers? Mm-hmm. And you may not be able to monitor, especially given if you change them, say, every 1.5 to 2 hours or whatever amount of time it is, that may be crucial time where mm-hmm. they're diarrhearing. So by the time you change, are there symptoms that you can watch on the outside that possibly would give you indications one needs to do another check, possibly
yes.
on the diapers?
Yes, with the diarrheal illnesses like cholera, as I mentioned earlier, it's a profuse kind of diarrhea, very frequent bouts of diarrhea. So if you find yourself that you're changing the diapers a little bit too frequently, and the fecal material is not allowed, because the diarrhea from cholera is, we ought to describe as rice water. Mm. So it's almost just like very watery, and you might feel that the child has urinated. So this is one of the clues that you can pick up and say, I'm changing the diapers too frequently. The other thing is that when children start becoming dehydrated, they become lethargic. Mm. So from the playful, bubbly child, you find a very dull child. The eyes can be sunken, okay? When they cry, there are no tears, okay? And when you pinch on their skin, it is very slow to return to its original. So we call that tenting. So the skin pinch is slow to return. These are pretty late signs of the dehydration.
Also, by the time the infant is tenting, then
yes.
you need to get to a health
facility. You really need to get to
possible.
As soon as possible. Mm-hmm. And if the child is not vomiting, give your ORS. Give your ORS as you're trying to get to the facility, so that the doctors do not have a hard time looking for an access to give their intravenous fluids. Mm-hmm. Getting to a facility where these fluids are given is important. So it's good to know your area so that you know that this is a facility that I can get an IV started. You want to go to a mid-level facility, not a very small center where they might not be having the IV fluids.
Okay.
Yes.
You mentioned that this, of course, by virtue of the fact that it's a sanitation, mainly sanitation issue, in remote areas and slum areas where this is found, what precautions can one take if they're in those areas or when they live in those areas?
Yeah.
Because you're more or less predisposed, especially like in slum areas, you're really predisposed to a lot of environments that make you vulnerable.
Yes. So I think when you're visiting areas where there's a cholera outbreak or in areas where you think the sanitation is not good, is that you take personal responsibility about your water and food sources. We encourage people to drink water that they can be sure of. Our tap water, unfortunately, is not that well sanitized. So it's good to avoid tap water. Drink boiled water. And the water should be boiled to a temperature of about 100 degrees, to the boiling until they're steaming, and then allowed to cool. The container where the water is kept should also be clean, because after the water has cooled, you could get contamination from that point. Use bottled water that you trust the source as you're drinking water. Always wash any food that you eat. In fact, we say that if for food, if you can't boil it, then cook it. If you can't cook it, then peel it. If you can't peel it, then don't eat it.
Okay.
So that's a good way to remind yourself of the importance of cleansing, especially foods that we do not cook, fruits and vegetables, and be very careful about eating from food vendors. You need to be sure that this person's sanitation is good to trust them to give you food.
Because that's the other thing, and when you talk about trusted food vendors, it becomes a little bit difficult because you don't know what happens in the kitchen. You merely trust that you know, you have your food made well, and the person who has done it is also not infected and clean. Because maybe I'd like to hear your comments, especially when it comes to restaurants. I've gone sometimes to maybe like a public facility for a toilet, and you find a cook, for example, with his overall and his hat in that same toilet, and of course they'll probably go back and not change. Mm-hmm. What are your comments on that? And you know, does the health ministry take care of anything like that?
Yeah, the Public Health Act and the county governments and now municipal government are meant actually to go around and inspect food premises to ensure that the food providers are clean and the kitchen is clean and so on. But I think to take it at your own personal responsibility, the advice really would be to avoid eat food that is steaming hot when it's served for you. For example, in a hotel or in occasions like wedding parties or outdoor eating, because once food is heated, it's possible to kill the bacteria. Mm. And then wash your hands before you eat your food, and wash your fruits. Mm. For example, fruits, you need to wash them and peel them, so that if you're not so comfortable with the sanitation of the person providing your food, then
you've taken action, and it's best
all right, to avoid eating that.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Jacob Shabani. But before we wind up, want to wind up now, possibly your rule of thumb, especially to avoid cholera. What is the one thing that you tell everybody right now that this should be your rule of thumb? This is something that you should practice wherever you are.
So the rule of thumb is wash your hands. I think if you wash your hands appropriately using running water and soap, then you will not get into contact with contaminated food. And then the other rule of thumb is proper fecal disposal. I think the onus is for the county governments and the national government to enforce rules about public health. For example, where do we construct our pit latrines? What is the schedule of emptying the pit latrines so that they are not overflowed? Creating proper sewerage systems, especially in the resource poor settings in the slums and in the rural areas. And finally is, if you suspect that you have cholera, then start your ORS as you get to the nearest facility. It is very key.
It's just a fast aid to get there. Thank you very much. That's Dr. Jacob Shabani from Aga Khan University Hospital and also a family medicine physician. Thank you very much for those updates. Well, we'll have to wind up Morning Express right there. Thank you very much for staying with us. But just to give you our Twitter poll results this morning, the question was, do you think the arrest of the legislators will tame their tongue? Well, we have 22% saying yes, they think that is going to tame their tongue. A whooping 78% say no, that is not going to tame their tongue. That is exactly where we're going to wind up Morning Express this morning. Thank you for staying with us. But do stay with us right here on KTN News. Coming up next is Najma Ismail with a program World View.